Hi friends, today we are going to be learn timestamp based protocol. So what is a timestamp? We have seen the log based protocol, and in that we have seen whenever we are working with a particular data item, we have to be acquire a shared or the exclusive lock on it. And then we can just work on the data items either for reading or writing. But what was the problem with the log-based protocol is it can lead to the deadlock situation. So the another protocol that we are going to study today is the timestamp-based protocol, which ensures the serializability. Now this timestamp is nothing but a timestamp value that is given for, it is a unique number that is given for the transaction, and which is denoted with timestamp TI, where TI can be any of the transaction that we are using in the system. So this is assigned by the database system before the start of the transaction execution. Now, whenever we are assigning the timestamp to the transaction, at that time, if the timestamp of TI, so TI is some transaction, if it is less than the timestamp of the TJ, it means that suppose I am having the timestamp value for TI is 5 and the timestamp value for the TJ is 10. What it means, if the timestamp value of TI is less, it means that it is the older transaction. So this one is the old. And which one is the younger transaction? The transaction that is coming after it, TJ, is the younger transaction, because TI comes into the system at 10 o'clock and the TJ comes into the system at the 10:50. So if timestamp value of TI becomes less than the timestamp value of TJ, it means that TI is the older transaction and TJ is going to be the new or the younger transaction that enter into the system. Now, the question comes, okay, how we are going to be assigned this timestamp value? So the timestamp value is going to be assigned with the system clock. So either I can make use of the system clock or I can make use of the logical counters whose value is incremented after the new timestamp has been assigned. So in this timestamp based protocol, we have to be only see to that okay, older transaction execution should be finished first. And after that, the younger transaction has to be finished its execution. So this thing is very important for this protocols. And whenever we are talking about the timestamp based protocol, the three important timestamps that we need to be understand is the timestamp value of the transaction. So just now we have talked about, okay, what is the timestamp value of TI? So it is the timestamp value that can be assigned by the system clock or by the logical counter. So at what time their execution start is the timestamp value of the TI. So three timestamp value is very important for us is the timestamp value of some transaction. Next is the write timestamp, which is the largest timestamp of any transaction that executes the write operation. With the example, I'll tell you how I can find out the write timestamp value. And similarly, I can have the read timestamp value, that is again the largest timestamp value of any transaction that executes the read. And it can be denoted with the RTS, and the write timestamp is denoted with the WTS. So with the example, now we are going to be see how this thing is going to be working. So you can see that okay, we are having the three transactions T1, T2, and T3. T1 is arrived in the system at 11 o'clock, T2 is arrived at 11:10, and T3 is arrived at 11:15. Okay, so this is the time that I am talking about. Let's assign some timestamp value to T1, T2, and T3. So just we'll assign the timestamp value to the T1 is 100, T2 is 200, and T3 is going to be 300. So this way we will assign the timestamp value to three transactions. Now out of this, if I will see which one is the older transaction, my T1 is going to be the older transaction. After that, T2 enter into the system at 11:10. This one is the younger transaction. And after that, T3 is arrived into the system. This one is the youngest transaction. So if I talk about the timestamp value of T1, T2, and T3, The timestamp value of T1 is 100, T2 is 200, and T3 is 300. Because for the problem solving, we are going to be take this timestamp value, not this actual time. So this is only for you to explaining purpose along with the system clock. So we are going to be take this timestamp value that is with the logical counter. Now, for the same problem, now we are going to be see what can be the read timestamp value and what can be the write timestamp value. So now suppose again, I will consider a three transaction, that is the T1 transaction, then the T2 transaction and the T3 transaction. The T1 transaction timestamp value is 10, T2 is 20 and T3 is 30. Which one is old? Old is T1. Which one is the youngest? Youngest is the T3. Now, suppose I want to be find out what is the read timestamp value on the data item A. So the data item can be anything, data item B, data item C, and so on. So now I want to be find out what is the read timestamp value. So you can see that whenever I'm performing the operation, my read of A will be done first by T1. So this is the first one who read the value of the data item A. This one is the second one who read the value of the data item A, T2 read second time, and third time, or I can say the latest, who is reading the value of A? It is the transaction T3, which is reading the value of A recently. So this is the largest timestamp value, that is T3, who is latest reading the value of A. So whenever I am finding out the read timestamp value of A, it is the timestamp value of the transaction T3, because the T3 is the one who is reading last the value of A. So if I want to find the value of read timestamp, it becomes the 30. Next, similarly, I can find out the write timestamp value. So same transaction T1, T2, T3. And now we will see who is performing the write first and who is performing the write last. So my T1 transaction is the old transaction who is writing the value of A first. T3 is a transaction who is writing the value of A second. And T2 is the transaction who is writing the value of A last. So T2 is the transaction which is currently writing the value of A. What is the timestamp value of T2? It is 20. So the write timestamp value of A now becomes 20. So with this, I can find out the read timestamp value and the write timestamp value. And we have to be see to that, okay, older transaction should execute first. So execution of the older transaction has to be done first in the system and after that, the younger transaction. So if I will see to this operations, suppose if I'll talk about T1, T2, T3, if T1 is the old one, after that the younger one is the T2, and after that the T3 has come into the system. So T1 has to be finish its execution first. After that, T2 has to finish its execution. And after that, the T3 has finished the execution. So the execution of the transactions has to be done in the timestamp order, whether they are older or whether they are younger. So older should execute first in the system. Now we will see, before going into the basic timestamp protocol, just we try to understand some of this concepts. So let's say T1 and the T2 are the two transactions. My timestamp value of T1 is 100 and the timestamp value of T2 is 200. So we know that T1 is the old one and T2 is the young one, because the timestamp value of T1 is less than the timestamp value of T2. Now suppose I'm having the two operations, read A. Now T1 is reading the value of A first, and after that T2 is writing the value of A. You can have one question, confusion in your mind, ki ma'am, this is the read and this is the write, these are the conflicting instructions. Because the conflicting instructions we have seen initially, we have when we have studied about the serial schedule and conflicting instructions. Now, this conflicting instructions are executed in the timestamp based method in the timestamp order. So you can see that whenever I'm talking about the timestamp based protocol, there will not be the deadlock situation that is arrived, because the conflicting instructions are going to be executed in the timestamp order. So if my T1 is the first one who is reading the value of A and T2 is the second one who wants to write the value of A, no problem. Older transaction wants to read it as read the value. Younger transaction wants to be write after that. It is allowed. No issue. Okay. अगर younger पहले आपका write कर रहा है और बाद में T1 को read करने के लिए मिल रहा है, then there is a problem. And for that I need the protocol. But if older is writing first or reading first, I shouldn't have any problem. So you can see that over here T1 is the old, T2 is the younger one. T1 is writing first, and after that T2 wants to write. No problem. It is going to be allowed. Over here you can see T1 write operation you want to be doing, and after that T2 wants to do the read operation. It is allowed. If I can have the read operation, T1 is reading first and after that T2 wants to read, it is allowed. So if I'm having this kind of order, at that time I don't have any problem, because older is doing its execution first and after that the younger is doing. But if I will have some kind of scenario like this, where I am having the T1 and either I am having the T2. T2 is the younger transaction who wants to write the value of A, or it wants to read. Okay, anything can be possible. So suppose T2 wants to write the value of A, and after that the T1 wants to read the value of A, then there is a problem, because younger is writing and after that older is asking for read. So this is whether this is going to be allowed or this is going to be not allowed, that we are going to be see with the basic timestamp protocol that we are going to be studying. Okay, so these are the basic concept that you should know about the timestamp. And now we will just switch over to the problem of the timestamp method. So this is a very simple problem. Okay, you people don't have to be just worry about what are the rules I have written over here. Okay, so with the problems, I will tell you the rules directly. Okay, so generally whenever we are talking about the transaction, they are going to be either read or write the data item. Now when we are having executing the transaction in a concurrent manner, some instructions of first transaction will be performed, some instruction of the second transaction will be performed, and some instruction of the third transaction. And all these instructions are going to be intermixed. So how it is going to be work in the basic timestamp protocol? So this is a basic timestamp protocol. So just again, now some of the rules we have seen, with those rules we will go and we try to solve this problem in the basic timestamp order. So before solving this problem, first of all, over here, I need the three timestamp value that we have already studied. That is the timestamp of the transaction that I can easily find out from the problem. Then what I need to be find out is the read timestamp value. The method I have already explained you how to find out the read timestamp value. And the second timestamp that I need to be find out for this problem is the write timestamp value. Okay, so these are three important things that we should able to know for while solving this problem. Okay, so now initially just I have solved this problem on the paper. So just I will tell you, initially I will make this matrix. All the three transactions are working on the data item A, B, and C. There are only three data items. Initially, the read timestamp value and write timestamp value I have initialized to zero. So just I will initialize it to zero. Okay, just you forget about what I have written after that. Okay, so just I have initialized it to zero in all the cases. So read timestamp value for B is zero. Write timestamp value for B is zero. Similarly, for C is also zero over here, and for write timestamp value initially it is zero. So it is zero zero in all the cases. So one by one, just we are trying to change this timestamp value when we are going to be solve the problem. So let's start with my first operation, read A operation. Okay, so just I'm going with my first operation, that is the read A. whenever a transaction wants to execute a read A. So this is the transaction T1 who is issuing a read operation. So if a transaction is issuing a read operation, at that time, I need to be follow some rules. What are those rules? So I have to be check the right timestamp value of A with the timestamp value of the transaction. So for what is the timestamp value of my T1 transaction? It is 100. Okay, just remember this. It is 100. Timestamp value of T2 is 200. Okay, already I have written with the problem, which as you can see, I have written over here. And the timestamp value T3 is 300. So the first, my first operation is the read A operation. I will follow the first rule. That is the TI issues a read A operation. So over here, I will check the right timestamp value of A, whether it is greater than the timestamp value of TI. TI ka timestamp value is the 100. What is the right timestamp value of A? I have initially initialized all this to zero. My read timestamp value is zero. My write timestamp value is zero for A. For B also it is 00. For C also it is 00. So initially it is zero. So how the condition I will check? The write timestamp value of A is zero and it is greater than 100 because this 100 is the timestamp value of the transaction. Then what I have to be do? I have to be, my this condition is true or false? This condition is false. So the first condition that is given for read is false over here. So what I will do? I will go to the second part, that is B. Then what I have to be do? Otherwise execute the read A operation and set the read timestamp value to be the maximum of read timestamp value of A and the timestamp value of TI. What is the read timestamp value of A? We will check in the table. The read timestamp value of A is 0. What is the timestamp value of TI? That means it is T1. T1 ka timestamp value 100 nikala hai humne. So 0 aur 100 ke beech mein max kaun sa hai? 100 hai. So abhi meri read timestamp value of A change ho jayegi aur ye kitni mil jayegi mujhe? 100 mil jayegi. Main change, maine yahan pe change kar diya. Jo mera initially jo 0 tha wahan pe maine usko 100 kar diya, cancel kar diya. Next, I will go for the second operation. Again, it is a read B operation. Again, I have to be go for the first condition. So in the first condition, you can see that now my transaction is changed. Instead of T1, now the transaction is T2. And it is working on which data item? It is working on B. But still the operation is read only. So again, I will do the same kind of thing. I will check the right timestamp value of B. What is the right timestamp value of B? It is initially zero only. So I will take the right timestamp value of B to be zero. What is the timestamp value of T2? Because the T2 is the transaction that is reading the value of B. So T2 ka timestamp value kitna hai? 200 hai. Is zero is greater than 200? No, this condition is false. I have to be go to the otherwise part. Otherwise part mein, again, I need to be find out the read timestamp value of B. Now we are working with the B. Read timestamp value of B and the timestamp value of transaction T2. So read timestamp value of B is initially zero because we have not yet updated it. And next is the timestamp value of my transaction T2 is 200, which is the maximum between 0 and 200. 200 is the maximum. Okay, so what I will do now? The read timestamp value of B, I will change to 200, the new value I have got, correct? Now next operation, the third operation, this is the second operation I have finished. Now I'm going for the third operation. My third operation is the write operation on C. Okay, so now I have got the write operation. Though I have read ke we have finished, now I have got the write operation. Now I have to be go for the second rule. What second rule says? If TI issues a write A operation, so instead of A, over here I'm having the C, no problem. The data item can be anything. Now, the two rules I have to be checked. Why two rules? Because we know that whenever we are having the write operation, it gets conflict with the read as well as it gets conflict with the write. So if I'm working on a data item A, my write A conflicts with the write A and my write A conflicts with the read A. So as there is a confliction in that, we are having these two rules. Now in these two rules, what we are supposed to do? We have to be check the read timestamp value of C with the timestamp value of my transaction T1 है ना ये जो write कर रहा है तो T1 तो मैं पहला condition check करूंगी my read timestamp value on the data item C is initially zero. So this is zero. This is again zero. So I will check my first condition. Zero is greater than what is the timestamp value of T1? It is 100. This condition I will check. My read timestamp value, is it greater than the timestamp value of TI? No. This condition is false. I will go to the next condition. In the next condition, what I will do, I will check now the write timestamp value. Write timestamp value of C is not, I have updated right now. It is zero only. So zero is greater than 100. This condition again false. I have to go to the C part. What I have to do? Execute the write C operation and set the write timestamp value of C as we are working with the C to the timestamp value of TI. What is the timestamp value of T1? It is 100. It means the write timestamp value of C I have to be set it to 100. So what I will do? I will just go to the write timestamp value and what it is C, I will change it to 100. Abhi maine ye update kar diya. Theek hai? Main underline karti jaati hu jahan jahan pe humne kiya hai. Dekho ye bhi kiya tha hum logon ne 200. Now I will go for the next operation, that is read B. So again read B has come. I have to go to my first rule because the operation is read operation. And which is the transaction that is reading? It is the T3 transaction whose timestamp value is 300. So now I will check again the write timestamp value of B. Is the write timestamp value of B is updated yet? No, it is not yet updated because nobody has written the value of B. So the write timestamp value of B is zero. So zero, what is the timestamp value of T3? That is 300. So this condition is false. I have to go to the second condition. I will come to the second condition, and in the second condition, I will find out the read timestamp value of B. What is the read timestamp value of B? B ka already we have updated it. It is 200. Okay, so I will write down the read timestamp value of B is 200. And what is the timestamp value of T3 transaction? It is 300. So between this 200 and the 300, which one is the max? 300 is the max. That means if the 300 is max, what I have to be do? I have to be update my read timestamp value of B to 300. So 200 gets upgraded to 300. Now my read timestamp value of B is 300. Now the next very important operation that we are getting is the read C operation. Okay, so read C operation is going to be the read operation. Again, I have to go with this read operation. I have to check the write timestamp value of C. Write timestamp value of C, we have changed it to 100. Okay, so is 100 is greater than the timestamp value of C? C ka T1 transaction is ka timestamp value 100 hai. So 100 is greater than 100? No. Equal to ka condition nahi diya hai. So ye condition false ho gaya. Then what I have to do? I have to go to the B part. I have to execute read operation. And while executing the read operation, I have to take the read timestamp value of C. So read timestamp value of C is not yet changed. It is zero only. And what is the timestamp value of T1 transaction? It is 100. Max kitna ho gaya? 100. अभी मेरा C का read timestamp change हो जाएगा. कितने को change हो जाएगा? 100 को. देखो ये भी change कर दिया मैंने. तो मेरा ये हो गया fifth operation. Now my sixth operation is very important. to see what is happening in the sixth operation. In the sixth operation, I am having a right B. I am having a right operation. Okay, so this right operation ke liye, I have to be go to my second rule. I have to be check the condition. Now, first condition I will check. On which data item it is working? It is working on B. What is the read timestamp value of B? Read timestamp value of B is 300. Just now we have find out. And what is the timestamp value of my transaction T2? It is 200. Now 300 is greater than 200. That means my condition is true over here. Then what I have to be do? I have to roll back this transaction. Okay. Because what is the problem happening over here? A younger transaction wants to write the value of B. So we are not allowed. We are first allowing the T1 to finish, after that T2 to finish, and after that T3 to finish. Okay. So there is a kind of write B that a younger transaction is doing, and we don't want to be do that. So what we are doing is we are rollbacking the transaction T2. And then the last operation is write of A. When the write of A is coming, I have to be go to the same condition. I have to be check the read timestamp value of A. What is the read timestamp value of A? We have upgraded it to 100. So 100 hai. Transaction ka timestamp value kitna hai? 300 hai. 100 is greater than 300. No, this condition is false. Next, I will check for the write timestamp. A ko abhi tak write nahi kiya hai. Okay, so iska timestamp value 0 hi hai. Timestamp value of T3 is 300. Both the conditions are false. Then what I have to be do? I have to be do the write operation. There's no problem in doing this write operation. And what will be the write timestamp value? It is the timestamp value of T3. So it comes to be 300. So now we can change the timestamp value of write timestamp value of A to be 300. So last one we have finished. So this way your basic timestamp is going to be